Okay, assalamualaikum. Salam sejahtera. Good afternoon, everyone. Okay, can you guys hear me? Boleh dengar ke? Okay, kita sedang menjemput rakan-rakan media kita untuk bersama-sama kita pada hari ini. Pertama-tamanya, saya mengucapkan selamat datang kepada semua untuk sesi engagement tentang berkaitan dengan vaksinasi remaja. So pada hari ini bersama-sama saya dengan pasukan Kementerian Kesihatan, saya ada beberapa pakar-pakar perunding dan pakar-pakar kesihatan awam dan juga pakar di hospital untuk memberi taklimat kepada kita semua berkaitan dengan vaksinasi remaja. Pertamanya saya ada Dr. Kalai Rasu yang merupakan pengarah Institute Clinical Research daripada NIH. Beliau akan memberikan sedikit taklimat berkaitan dengan efikasi vaksinasi dan akan ada beberapa data tentang pengalaman di dalam negara kita berkaitan vaksin yang telah kita gunakan COVID-19. Ya. Selepas itu, kita akan mendapatkan sedikit pandangan daripada Dr. Nik Khairuddin Nik Yusof yang merupakan pakar perunding penyakit berjangkit kanak-kanak daripada Hospital Raja Perempuan Zainab 2 Kota Baru, dan beliau akan memberikan overview berkaitan dengan vaksinasi remaja. Dan kita ada juga bersama kita pada hari ini Datuk Dr. Zulkifli Ismail yang merupakan pakar perunding kanan kanak-kanak dan juga pakar perunding kardiologi kanak-kanak daripada Hospital KPJ Selangor. Kita ada juga doktor, mereka akan memberikan pandangan dari segi kardiologi dan kanak-kanak. Dan kita juga ada Dr. Benedict yang merupakan pakar perunding penyakit berjangkit daripada Hospital Sungai Buloh memberikan maklumat sedikit tentang data di Sungai Buloh. Ya. Selain itu, kita akan juga akhiri pembentang ketiga merupakan Dr. Sadatul Nubaya daripada Family Health Development Division yang bertanggungjawab tentang pelaksanaan program vaksinasi kebangsaan. Ya. Jadi, kita akan memberikan masa lebih kurang 10 minit kepada mereka untuk memberikan pemandangan. Lepas itu, kita akan membuka soalan yang berkaitan. Ya. So, relevant question with regards to the presentation by the consultants and the specialist following the pembentangan. Sebab itu kita akan teruskan dengan pembentangan berikutnya. Dan hopefully by pembentangan ketiga, kita akan kumpulkan semua soalan-soalan itu. Kalau ada soalan sebagainya, kita akan cuba jawab. Dan mereka yang tidak dapat jawab in detail itu, kita akan memberi jawapan secara bertulis. Ya. Okay, without further ado, saya menjemput Dr. Kalai Rasu Parasami untuk memberikan pembentangan beliau. Ya. Please, Kalai.
Selamat tengah hari dan salam sejahtera yang bahagia Datuk Dr. Hisham Shah, our Deputy Director General of Health for Research and Technical Support. Bersama saya ada pakar perubatan dan juga dalam pakar kesihatan awam, termasuk daripada ahli datang kuasa yang menjalankan kaji sidik keberkesanan vaksin COVID-19. Okay. So, salam sejahtera dan selamat tengah hari kepada semua. Saya Dr. Kalai, pengarah daripada Institut Penyelidikan Klinikal. Saya akan memberi keterangan sedikit tentang kajian-kajian dan juga apa yang kita lihat daripada keberkesanan vaksin yang digunakan dalam program imunisasi COVID-19 kebangsaan, iaitu digelar PIK. Dalam program imunisasi PIK setakat 21 September 2021, sejumlah 40.9 juta dos telah diberi. Dan daripadanya 18.7 juta adalah dos lengkap, iaitu 2 dos telah diberi dan 14 hari selepas itu diiktiraf sebagai lengkap menerima vaksin. Dalam negara kita dapati hampir 80.2% penduduk dewasa telah pun menerima vaksin, dan dalam golongan ini hampir 58% sarang iaitu populasi kita telah pun lengkap vaksinasi. Program PIK yang kita kaitkan sekarang sebenarnya melibatkan beberapa vaksin. Dan antara vaksin yang kita menggunakan daripada peringkat awal ialah vaksin Pfizer, seterusnya vaksin Sinovac dan kemudian AstraZeneca, dan baru-baru ini bulan Ogos ialah vaksin CanSino. Vaksin CanSino ialah vaksin yang menggunakan satu dos sahaja untuk melengkapkan vaksinasi. Daripada peratusan vaksin yang telah pun diberi setakat ini, hampir 46% adalah vaksin Pfizer, 45% adalah vaksin Sinovac, 8% adalah vaksin AstraZeneca. Kesemua vaksin yang kita guna pakai dalam program ini, terutamanya dari segi pemilihan dan sebagainya, ia menjalani satu proses yang ketat. Satu ialah ia melalui pemilihan jawatan kuasa di bawah jawatan kuasa akses vaksin negara, JKJF. Dan dari sini data-data diteliti dan pengesyuran dibuat kepada jawatan kuasa yang dipenguruskan bersama oleh Menteri Kesihatan dan juga Menteri Mesti. Seterusnya, vaksin tersebut mestilah mendapat kelulusan MPRA, iaitu Badan Regulatory Pharmaceutical di negara, dan ia mesti memenuhi syarat tertentu, iaitu ia mesti selamat, berkualiti dan berkesan. Dalam pandemik COVID-19, untuk kita menjadi satu rujukan, WHO telah pun menetapkan bahawa sesuatu vaksin itu mestilah lebih daripada 50% dari segi efikasinya. Jadi ketiga-tiga syarat ini perlulah dipenuhi sebelum sesuatu vaksin itu digunakan. Kedua ialah semua vaksin yang kita mencalonkan dan seterusnya digunakan mesti mempunyai keupayaan untuk mengurangkan tiga perkara. Satu ialah mengurangkan jangkitan. Kedua, iaitu yang lebih penting, ialah risiko penyakit teruk dalam COVID-19. Dan seterusnya ialah mengurangkan peratusan kematian akibat COVID-19. Kita tahu setakat ini hampir 25,000 orang telah pun meninggal akibat COVID-19 di negara kita. Ketiga ialah vaksin itu mestilah berkesan terhadap beberapa kumpulan, termasuklah warga emas yang dewasa dan juga sekarang ialah pada golongan remaja dalam bidang pemberian vaksin. Ini adalah trend pesakit COVID-19 yang kita dapat perhatikan. Data yang kita kumpulkan di sini adalah pada peringkat permulaan vaksinasi secara luas di negara kita, iaitu 1 April dan sehingga kini, iaitu pertengahan bulan September. Apa yang kita lihat ialah apabila peratus vaksinasi itu meningkat dan mencapai tahap lebih daripada 40% dan ke atas, kita mula lihat penurunan kes COVID-19. Dalam rajah ini kita lihat bila sampai ke hujung bulan Ogos, apabila telah capai 46% melengkapi vaksinasi, kita mula lihat pengurangan daripada segi pesakit COVID-19. Downtrend ini adalah satu yang tetap sekarang dan kita lihat daripada pemberitahuan harian, bilangan ini adalah berkurangan. Seperti yang kita maklum semalam ialah 14,000 dan kita anggap bahawa ini adalah petanda yang amat baik dari segi efikasi vaksin. Ini adalah trend kematian akibat COVID-19. Ini juga menunjukkan trend yang menurun. Dan apabila kita perhatikan trend ini, semenjak pertengahan bulan September, middle of September, kita dah pun nampak penurunan kes kematian. The trend is on a decline. Biasanya trend ini menurun lebih kurang 2 minggu selepas trend kes kemasukan COVID-19 itu menurun. Seperti yang kita lihat tadi, pada penghujung bulan Ogos, kita lihat kes-kes COVID.
Hello. Line bubble please.
Dan mulai sekarang, pertengahan bulan September, kita lihat penurunan daripada tren kematian juga. Ini juga menunjukkan satu ketanda yang baik. Dan pada peringkat ini kita lihat hampir 55%, 55% of the population telah pun lengkap di vaksinasi. Dari kematian yang berlaku akibat COVID-19, ini adalah statistik yang terkumpul daripada Mortality Review Committee, di mana kita juga lihat penjelasan yang diberi oleh press statement daripada Ketua Pengarah Kesihatan. Kita dapat lihat case fatality rate. Ini bermakna setiap 10,000 orang yang terjangkit COVID-19, hampir 115 orang ada kemungkinan meninggal dunia akibat COVID-19. Memberi case fatality rate 1.15%. Status ini sebenarnya telah berubah sepanjang setahun ini. Pada tahun lepas, apabila kita menjalankan kajian, pada masa itu, case fatality rate untuk hampir 6,000 case COVID-19 pada wave 1 dan wave 2, kita lihat angkanya adalah hampir 1.2%. Pada masa itu, kita tidak terjejas oleh varian Delta. Oleh itu, apabila kita lihat kes fatality rate pada bulan 9 tahun lepas dan hingga Disember bulan tahun lepas, kes fatality rate sebenarnya adalah rendah, hampir 0.4% hingga 0.5% sahaja. Manakala bermula pada awal tahun ini dan sehingga ke pertengahan tahun ini, kita lihat secara beransur kes fatality rate telah meningkat. Nah, satu daripada sebabnya ialah variants of concern yang telah melanda negara kita. Bukan saja di sini, juga di benua Asia Tenggara dan di negara Asia seluasnya. Dalam data yang kita paparkan ini, kita lihat hampir 84% yang meninggal akibat COVID-19 adalah golongan yang mempunyai comorbidity, terutamanya darah tinggi, diabetes, hypercholesterolemia, juga penyakit jantung dan juga penyakit kidney. Mereka adalah biasanya yang golongan berumur usia tinggi, tetapi kita juga lihat keadaan NCD tinggi di golongan orang dewasa juga. So kita lihat ratusan yang meninggal dunia akibat COVID-19 juga merangkumi mereka yang berumur 40 tahun ke atas. Kebiasaannya ialah akibat comorbidity. Dari segi gender difference, iaitu antara lelaki dan wanita, peratusan untuk wanita telah mula meningkat dalam beberapa bulan yang lepas. Ini mungkin disebabkan mereka sebelum ini mereka tidak lagi termasuk dalam golongan yang risiko tinggi. So this is something we also observe. Ini adalah model bilangan COVID-19 dari segi active case, maknanya yang termasuk di dalam hospital dan juga quarantine center dan juga di mana-mana mereka diawasi. So this is actually active cases daripada semua case-case yang kita lihat digelar positif. Dan model ini kita telah wujudkan berdasarkan beberapa parameter. Pertama ialah kita memberi efikasi lebih kurang 60% untuk semua vaksin. Kedua, kita menggunakan model data sebenar sehingga penghujung bulan Ogos. Daripada model ini kita lihat our active cases sebenarnya telah pun sampai pada tahap tertinggi pada penghujung bulan Ogos. Dan selepas itu, active cases juga menurun sama seperti daily cases. Dan kita harap pada penghujung tahun ini, kita pun mencapai lebih kurang 4,000 atau ke bawah case COVID secara aktif dirawat di hospital kita. Ini juga menunjukkan efikasi vaksin kita dari segi keberkesanannya yang membawa kepada penurunan kes-kes COVID-19. Jadi kita lihatlah kepada data yang diwujudkan daripada kajian sebenar yang kita lakukan. Now, this is very important because you want to evaluate how effective are the vaccines. Ini adalah satu yang perlu dilakukan sebab ada beberapa portfolio vaksin yang kita gunakan di Malaysia. Jadi kajian RICOVAM yang dilakukan secara tulus, kita mendata di bawah National Medical Research Registry, dapat kelulusan Medical Ethics Research Board, MREC. Ini adalah kajian yang bergabung antara the CITF Research Team, di mana kita ada Dr. Burhan dan Encik Suar di sini, dan juga Mr. Ramesh, dan juga daripada ICR NIH yang diketuai oleh Datin Syamini dan Sumin, dan juga anggota-anggota lain kita akan namakan ini. So mereka menggunakan dua kaedah untuk mengkaji keberkesanan vaksin. So they use two methods. One is a screening method. The other is to use a cohort. Cohort ialah berdasarkan kepada semua kes COVID-19, iaitu pesakit yang kita dapat teliti data mereka. Screening method menggunakan data yang mereka menerima vaksin, fully vaccinated, berbanding dengan mereka yang tidak mencukupi atau melengkapi dos vaksin ataupun tidak mengambil vaksin. So, fully vaccinated versus unvaccinated. Based on these two methods, mereka dapat menjana empat data yang amat penting. Satu ialah from the screening method, sama ada vaksin sebenarnya membawa pengurangan peratusan risiko jangkitan, juga sama ada pengurangan peratusan jangkitan bergejala. So this is one outcome from these screening method. The other using the COVID-19 cohort, ialah menunjukkan sama ada pengurangan peratus risiko masuk ke ICU dan juga risiko kematian. So kita lihat data yang kita dapat jana daripada kajian. So caranya ialah sedemikian, data negara dari segi senarai kes COVID-19 digabungkan dengan senarai yang mereka telah diberi vaksin atau tidak. Seterusnya mereka disenaraikan daripada data yang termasuk dalam ICU dan juga rekod kematian kebangsaan. Kesemua data ini digabungkan dan dibuat analisis. Dan apabila kita melakukan analisis, we also take into consideration, especially for the modeling as well as for the analysis using regression method. We look at gender, our nationality, age. More importantly is our comorbidity, very important. This is something that the research team had to work very hard to get enough information to link to the vaccine evaluation outcome. Dan juga gejala dari segi kemasukan hospital dan juga daripada spesifiknya daripada state-state dalam Malaysia. So untuk kita memberi penerangan lanjut, kita perlu mengambil dua tafsiran. Satu ialah apa itu dos lengkap. Dos lengkap ialah 14 hari selepas menerima dos kedua. Ini tidak termasuk mRNA yang baru sahaja bulan 8 dimasukkan. Dos separuh ialah tempoh antara dos pertama sehinggalah 14 hari selepas dos kedua. Jadi itu adalah partially vaccinated. Ini adalah penting sebab analisa menggunakan dua tafsiran. Apabila kita menggunakan tafsiran ini dan membuat analisa, dari segi kajian population, datanya adalah daripada mereka yang sedemikian, 1.26 million people have been involved in this particular study. And if you look at this study, what you can see is number one, for those who have partially received vaccinated status, iaitu yang pertama sekali, keberkesanan vaksin secara keseluruhan untuk partially ialah hanya lebih kurang 51% untuk jangkitan COVID-19. Apabila mereka mendapat dos fully status fully vaccinated itu 14 hari selepas dos kedua, keberkesanannya ialah hampir 88%. Ini adalah untuk mengurangkan jangkitan. Ini adalah penting daripada semua dos-dos yang telah diberi kepada populasi kita, data daripada 1.2 juta ini dianalisikan. This is the most important outcome that we found out. Dari segi jangkitan bergejala, that is symptomatic infection from COVID, For those who are fully vaccinated, vaksin sebenarnya mengurangkan risiko jangkitan simptomatik hampir 86%, iaitu antara 84% hingga 88%. Sekiranya partially vaccinated, dia punya keberkesanan hanya 35%. Ini bermakna sekiranya seseorang itu telah menerima kedua-dua dos dan 14 hari selepas itu, vaksin efficacy amat robust. Ia mencapai lebih daripada 86% dan 88% untuk jangkitan bergejala dan juga jangkitan. Sebelum tadi saya telah menerangkan, WHO menerangkan pada pandemik efficacy yang paling rendah ialah 50% dan data sebenar Malaysia menunjukkan tahapnya adalah amat tinggi. Kedua ialah kemasukan ke unit rawatan rapi. Ya. Ini adalah data daripada COVID-19, 1.26 million population again, daripada semua yang telah diberi vaksinasi. Again, overall, kemasukan ke dalam ICU, for those who are fully vaccinated, the reduction of ICU risk is as high as 83%. Very important. Keberkesanan vaksin mengurangkan kemasukan ke ICU ialah 83% di kalangan mereka yang ada COVID-19. Tapi sekiranya mereka hanya mencapai keberkesanan separa, iaitu incompletely vaccinated, insufficiently in the time period, keberkesanan adalah rendah, 38% sahaja. Jadi, macam tadi, untuk gejala dan penyakit sahaja, kita nampak dua dos adalah amat penting. Sama juga untuk kemasukan ICU. Seseorang itu mesti memenuhi dos kedua dan mencapai status fully vaccinated untuk menikmati efficacy yang tinggi. Antara vaksin-vaksin yang kita telah gunakan, kita juga dapat analisa data dari segi keberkesanannya. On that account, if you look at AstraZeneca, for ICU reduction is as high as more than 90%. Similarly, for Pfizer, is more than 90%. For Sinovac, is as close to 80%, 75% to 79%. And all these vaccines, if you have completed your dose and fully vaccinated, they have very high efficacy to reduce ICU risk. If your single dose or incomplete within the vaccination time, they are below the 50% mark. Therefore, you are higher risk of the ICU admitted. The AstraZeneca data itu nampak sedikit tinggi untuk dos pertama. Ini adalah perbezaan masa antara mereka yang menerima dos kedua dan dos pertama, sebab AstraZeneca sebenarnya adalah jarak yang amat jauh dan efficacy-nya meningkat dalam tempoh itu. So, dia hampir kepada dos kedua sebenarnya. Alright? Dan juga bilangan mereka yang menerima AstraZeneca adalah rendah berbanding dengan Pfizer dan Sinovac. Jadi datanya mungkin berubah untuk masa hadapan. So untuk simpulan, so in terms of a summary, AstraZeneca reduced the risk of ICU admission by 96%, Pfizer by 92%, and Sinovac by 77%. This is for death, kematian. Sama juga populasi 1.26 juta pesakit COVID-19. Daripada semua yang telah pun menerima vaksin, kita lihat. Secara overall, those who are fully vaccinated, death is reduced by as high as 88%. The range is 87% to 88%. So amat tinggi reduction of death. And if you are only partially vaccinated, it's only about 50% for that purpose, for reduction of death risk. And again, if you compare the three vaccine portfolios, all of them are fully vaccinated. The reduction of death impact is higher than 80% for Sinovac, 90% and above for both Pfizer and AstraZeneca. So the message is very clear. Those who are fully vaccinated gave the maximum benefit from the vaccine, both for disease, having symptomatic COVID, for reduction for ICU admission, and reduction of death risk. That is the message we must all understand. Fully vaccinated status is very, very important. So secara kesimpulan again, AstraZeneca reduce the risk of death for COVID-19 patients 96%, for Pfizer about 93%, and for Sinovac is 84%. Again, they are very highly efficacious vaccines. So I just want to go through a little bit on where we are now, having achieved high levels of vaccine efficacy for both of those parameters. One is, kalau kita lihat seseorang itu yang mungkin ada risiko terjangkit COVID-19, kalau mereka terjangkit, mereka sebenarnya, they have primary infection, dan mereka akan mewujudkan antibody secara natural. So this is a natural antibody response for an infected, recovered person. The second thing is, of course, for those of us who are vaccinated, we don't need to go through an infection pathway to develop immunity. We are vaccinated to achieve the immunity. So ini adalah proses yang kita memberi vaksin. Dan di sini, mereka mendapat immunity yang sesuai untuk melawan penyakit COVID-19. So we saw the result. But for both this natural immunity and for those who have been vaccinated, there's always a risk of reduction of these antibody levels over time. This is what we call waning effect. And we know currently it's about 6 to 8 months for some of the neutralizing antibodies. But for long-term immunity, the data is still being compiled, and we do not really know how long would your memory cells give you the immunity that is desirable against COVID-19. So anyone from natural immunity or vaccinated can become partially susceptible later. And this is something that eventually we recognize as a breakthrough infection. Dan kita juga menyelidik tentang isu ini. Ya. Dan kita akan memberi sedikit penerangan tentang apa yang berlaku dalam segi breakthrough infection. So ini adalah data breakthrough infection. Sesuatu yang kita perlu lihat ialah pada peringkat awal, when you have achieved fully vaccinated status, within the first month, your risk of breakthrough infection in terms of percent is very low, less than 1%. Amat rendah sekali. As we go through another 30 days and further, the breakthrough infection rate increases above 1%, doubles a bit later, and then doubles a bit later. Now, at about 4 months, the breakthrough infection rate is about 5%. So overall, we recognize that our country has demonstrated a breakthrough rate of about 1.3 for every 100 person. This is the vaccinated population. We have seen that, we calculated that. But this rate increases over a period of time. And that is as understandable because of the earlier explanation that there could be a waning effect. Dan kebanyakan breakthrough ini berlaku dalam tempoh sebulan selepas mencapai status pemberian vaksinasi. So if anyone is to develop a breakthrough infection, it tends to happen within a month or after about 2 months, and they are often identified early. So this is how the data is shown. For those breakthrough infection, let's look in detail. For the vaccine, for overall vaccine. So this is studied based on 14 million samples overall. Tadi for the other data, this goes to about 20 million. This is the 14 million. And what you see is interesting, that the number of ICU admission for breakthrough for the whole population is actually extremely low. Is about 0.01% for AstraZeneca, 0.02% for Pfizer, 0.1% for Sinovac. Overall, the rate is about 0.066% for those who have fully been vaccinated. So the breakthrough rate for ICU admission is extremely low. So kebanyakan mereka bergejala pada tahap 1 atau 2 dan tidak kepada tahap 4 dan 5 di mana mereka memerlukan ICU. So breakthrough infection does happen, but they do not deteriorate to that level fast. But this may change with the conditional condition of waning effect. This is something we have to monitor. Likewise for death, kematian, 14 juta orang yang telah diberi vaksin dan dilihat daripada peratusan ini, kematian amat amat kurang. So for AstraZeneca is 0.02%, Pfizer is 0.05%, and Sinovac is 0.15% and 0.1% overall. Overall, so there's some variations in this as well. So why is there a variation for this? Again, AstraZeneca, the distribution was perhaps a bit lesser in proportion. Also, the population that received the vaccine was slightly different demographically. Many of them were in the mid-adulthood age, whereas Pfizer and Sinovac were very much more for the vulnerable population. And we have seen the same issue in terms of the proportion of death by this comorbidity. And that is something that is very important to recognize. Yaitu di kalangan mereka yang meninggal selepas breakthrough, 76% mereka adalah lebih daripada 60 tahun dan 92% mempunyai comorbidity. The same risk factors of COVID-19 applies for breakthrough infection, although it's low, but it's still driven by the risk of age and risk of comorbidity. So this is something that we have to address and see whether there's something in terms of identifying this risk factor. So in summary, up to 12 September, among COVID-19 patients, if you have completed vaccinated, meaning 14 days after your second dose, your risk reduction for ICU admission is as high as 83%, and your risk reduction for death is as high as 88%. This is way above the minimum standard set by the 50% set by the WHO, not very important. Although in trial efficacy, you find different results between 70 to 80 to 95%. This is real world data. And much of this data is consistent among not only Malaysian data, but even if you look at the data from Brazil, from Chile, even looking at Turkey and many other parts, Israel included, we are not that different in terms of real world data. And if you look at a simple ballpark figure, for everyone who's admitted to ICU, in terms of being vaccinated, in fact, for every 67 who was there, the vaccine, in fact, avoids 1% being declared, succumbed to COVID-19. So this is how you interpret the data. Very important that we look at the vaccine efficacy in that sense. So some have asked this question, is this very different with the various of concern? Well, there's still ongoing work on our side. But from the most recent publication from the CDC data published in British Medical Journal, for those who are unvaccinated in COVID-19 and were infected, your risk of death is 11 times higher than someone who's vaccinated. It therefore shows that fully being vaccinated, in fact, is the most important criteria if you wish to reduce the risk of death in COVID-19. So in simpulan, we have demonstrated this is a very dynamic study and this we continued. Overall, our PIC vaccines have been very effective. They've reduced the infection. They've reduced the severe outcome of COVID, both in symptomatic disease, ICU admission and death. And in that sense, it has also lessened the burden of a healthcare system so they can cope with many other situations as well. So this is very important role and function of the COVID-19 vaccine. This is a team that worked very hard on this work. Dr. Tung Bun Hua, Mrs. Sua, Dr. Mrs. Tevesh, Dr. Mahesh from CPRC, Datin Shamini, Mr. Ong, and Dr. Masliyama, and also the talk from the ICR NIH. And on behalf of our ICR, I'd like to thank Dato for giving me the opportunity to share this information. Thank you very much.
Okay, terima kasih, Dr. Kalai. Thank you, Dr. Kalai. I think we are going to probably just have a very maybe dua burning question, lepas tu kita move on. Kalau tak, tak sempat habis ya. Boleh kita ada any two burning question in terms of vaccine efficacy? Soalan kepada Dr. Kalai berkaitan dengan efficacy vaccine. Ada? Boleh kita dapatkan apa-apa soalan daripada rakan-rakan media kita? Kalau ada penjelasan yang ingin diutarakan. Kalau tak ada, kita tunggu sampai the last speaker. Kita combinekan semua, ya.
Excuse me, doctor. I have a question. I'm Kanmani from Code Blue.
Let me see. Okay, Kanmani. Okay, Code Blue. Yeah.
Okay. So can MOH share the evidence of waning immunity from vaccines in Malaysia that justify administration of booster shots? Because immunocompromised people should be able to get a third dose, and that should be included in the primary series of vaccination because they don't respond well to two doses. But for everyone else, including the elderly with comorbidities, what is the evidence that they need booster shots?
Okay, Kamini, maybe I can the one who's doing the study is not here, and from IKU, we are in the midst of doing post vaccination sero conversion and sero surveillance studies, meaning that we do the baseline before getting vaccination, and then 1 month after getting vaccination, periodically for up to maybe up to 2 years. Since we have done I think probably 600 data sets for Pfizer, 600 for Sinovac, and then for AstraZeneca about the same amount. And we are beginning to collect data for CanSino as well. Thus far, we only have data up to the vaccination after second dose, the level of antibody after the second dose. So we can't give you the details of what is the findings, but the findings is very much in keeping what's happening elsewhere with regards to the antibody levels post vaccination after following the first vaccination and following the second dose of vaccination. So the data mimics very closely with that. So I think probably in times to come, we can probably get the more robust and mature data, because we just started the vaccination from March this year. So we don't have that mature data set that you require, because you require 6 months, 8 months, 9 months, or 12 months kind of post-vaccination. We don't have that data at the moment. Yeah. With regards to the third dose, FDA have already approved the use of third dose in immunocompromised patients. We have already made decision to also allow that third dose for those who are immunocompromised. With regards to the third dose in the other categories of patients, I think FDA just approved, I think earlier today, the other groups of people who would benefit from a third dose, yeah, or so-called the booster dose. I think we are going to probably have some announcement. I think YABPM have made an announcement that we're going to start booster doses, certainly amongst those who are immunocompromised, but certain category of high-risk groups, yeah, not all, but certain category of people would be amenable to. We are going to give booster dose because they are in the high risk category. So what we are doing is everything is evidence based, and everything is according to what's being approved given the available data. Okay, I hope that satisfies that question.
Doctor, I have another question as well. Is the government is rolling out booster doses because of concerns of Sinovac efficacy? Because according to the Selangor State Health Department, they released data yesterday, 82% of deaths among the fully vaccinated individuals, a total of 418 of them, comprised of Sinovac recipients, compared to 17% Pfizer recipients and 1% of AstraZeneca recipients. So it's actually quite high. It's almost 20% in September, 20% of breakthrough deaths in September. Whereas in US, fully vaccinated deaths comprise of only less than 1% of total deaths. So what's your comment on this, Doctor?
I think that one is preliminary data. We are also watching closely with regards to the efficacy of vaccine. Whatever vaccine that we have would be vaccine which has actually been approved by NPRA, and it has reached the floor value of at least 50% efficacy. So that's why we have the portfolio of vaccine which is available that we are utilizing. All of the vaccine that we use have reached that minimum standard, minimum set level of efficacy. When you look at Sarawak, for instance, they have mainly used Sinovac during the ramp up of their vaccination. And you can see drastically how much that the level of reduction in the death and ICU admissions, so on and so forth. Although they may have cases may get breakthrough infection, but then the one who are in the severe groups are much less. So given the circumstances, you should look at the overall efficacy of all of our vaccine portfolio. And given that we've got 5 vaccines at the moment, we try to get as much vaccine as possible amongst all of the manufacturers. And at the moment, most of the vaccine supply are from Pfizer. And secondly, it is from Sinovac because we've got the fill and finish facility in Malaysia and AstraZeneca. So that's how we are looking at it. Whether we are not going to start the booster vaccination just because of one vaccine or another, we look at the overall picture. We notice that a certain category of people are probably better protected if we give them the dose. So that would include those who are immunocompromised, and secondly, those who are in the high risk category. For instance, people who are constantly being exposed to the virus due to the nature of their job. That would include the healthcare workers, the frontliners, and certain other categories. And so those are the kind of people that we are going to probably concentrate on. And the other group that we are looking into in giving the booster doses are some high-risk category, those with certain comorbidities that we are going to probably also give them vaccines. So it as a whole, the vaccine that we've given our population is the vaccine that has actually reached the efficacy level. And the vaccine that we have deployed during our vaccination program, we as we receive the vaccine, we deploy it. So at the moment, I think the rate of vaccination is, I think, almost like 95%. Once we get the vaccine, we deploy it. We vaccinate the population. That is why Malaysia has got one of the highest rate of vaccination worldwide. So that's what, as much I can see, the details of those, you know, if you are going to split hairs, I think we can discuss that a bit later. The details, we are not there yet in terms of looking at the details in our population, because we can only do the neutralizing antibody against the spike protein. But if you look at the inactivated vaccine, there are other levels that can go into play as well. The nucleocapsid antibodies and other immune cells. We are not measuring that. Okay, so it's a bit more complex, and we don't have the details to give you some answer at the moment.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Okay, Haris. Later.
Doctor, one question for doctor. It's regarding the waning effect.
Okay,
I would like to ask Dr. Kalai. Do you have comparison between vaccines? Time period, waning effect ni between Pfizer, Sinovac, and AstraZeneca, and also maybe CanSino kalau ada.
CanSino, no, I don't. Tak ada. Tapi Kalai, did you have the data on that from your RevCom studies?
So actually, the data is still being compiled because we only started the mass vaccination from about early April, and so most of the vaccine portfolios, you know, they've come to about 6 months now. Yeah. We've got some data for our healthcare series, and we also have the IQ study that with IMR that Dato was mentioning for population sample as well for the various vaccines.
Yeah,
but. There are several models of study anyway. Some are with symptomatic disease PCR tests as well, and some with serology. So we will be able to share this information once the study undergoes at least the interim analysis phase. At least for the healthcare workers in October, we will be able to share that outcome for if at all there's a waning effect for some of the vaccine portfolios. So you need to be a little patient, and we should have that very soon. Thank you.
For how many breakthrough infections among healthcare workers, because they are among the first to receive. So to date, how many breakthrough infections?
Of about 550 healthcare workers, we have had 30 breakthrough infections, all in category 1 and 2, and all recovered. So that is how we have so far.
Yeah. Okay, Haris. I think even data for the booster shot kan by Pfizer, they showed the waning starts coming down by maybe about 8 months or 6 months or 8 months. So it starts to come down. But the levels are still there. Meaning that dia punya GMT, dia punya geometric mean punya level, kalau dia gunakan for neutralizing the virus, apparently it still works. But definitely the levels are waning. So that's why diorang kata in certain categories, you need to give booster doses. And today they have approved the booster doses for I think 3 main category of patients or people. I've not had the time to look at the FDA punya apa tu statement yet, yeah. Tapi you can Google and see whether is it out yet. Yeah? So I think in interest of time, we can move on and see whether we can collate all the information, the question later, yeah, after the information, after the presentation. I think the next presentation, maybe Dr. Nick Khairuddin, maybe you can just give briefly apa tu your presentation. Kita go a bit focus on our adolescent, okay, vaccination. Dr. Nik Khairuddin, ya, daripada Kota Baru.
Okay. Terima kasih, Datuk. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh dan salam sejahtera. Saya Dr. Nik Khairuddin Nik Yusof, pakar perunding pediatrik infectious disease daripada Hospital Raja Perempuan Zainab 2. Jadi saya cuma akan memberikan sedikit pembentangan mengenai guidelines, ya, clinical vaksinasi di kalangan remaja, ya, sebenarnya. Bagaimana kita tahu bahawa kerajaan telah memutuskan untuk meneruskan vaksinasi di kalangan remaja, dan guideline ini adalah untuk remaja yang berumur antara 12 hingga 17 tahun. Pada masa ini belum ada vaksin di seluruh dunia yang memberikan kebenaran untuk vaksinasi di bawah umur 12 tahun, ya. Dan tapi mungkin dalam masa terdekat juga akan ada bukti-bukti klinikal yang membenarkan vaksin diberikan kepada yang bawah daripada 12 tahun. Tapi perbincangan kita pada hari ini adalah menekankan kepada yang berumur 12 hingga 17 tahun, ya. Jadi kita nak tekankan di sini juga bahawa ada masih lagi ada sebilangan besar populasi kita itu yang tidak diberi vaksinasi. Yang ini termasuk ialah kanak-kanak yang kecil, ya, kanak-kanak yang berumur kurang daripada 12 tahun. Jadi amat penting penekanan diberikan untuk memastikan all the eligible adults, ya, all the orang-orang dewasa dan juga remaja yang telah mencapai umur untuk divaksinasi diberikan vaksinasi untuk melindung adik-adik mereka ataupun anak-anak kecil yang berada di rumah. So kita nak tekankan bahawa walaupun vaksinasi remaja diteruskan, bahawa vaksinasi untuk orang-orang dewasa juga perlu terus dijalankan untuk melindungi kumpulan-kumpulan yang tidak dapat diberikan vaksinasi, terutamanya kanak-kanak kecil, ya. Dan secara ringkasnya, rekomendasi daripada clinical guidelines ini adalah pertama adalah kita mencadangkan dan atau memberikan keutamaan bahawa semua remaja yang mempunyai masalah kesihatan comorbid, ya, chronic comorbidity diberikan keutamaan kerana mereka can get very ill. Mereka mungkin mendapat COVID-19 yang teruk, ya. Secara keseluruhan kita mengatakan bahawa remaja dan juga kanak-kanak tidak mendapat COVID yang teruk, tetapi ada sebilangan daripada mereka yang mempunyai risiko tertentu akan mempunyai risiko untuk mendapat jangkitan yang lebih serius. Remaja-remaja lain juga disarankan untuk mendapatkan COVID-19, vaksin COVID-19 kerana mereka juga boleh mendapat jangkitan COVID-19 yang serius, ya, although the risk is lower than the worst with medical comorbidities. Jadi vaksin yang direkomend atau yang diberikan yang disarankan dipakai adalah Pfizer vaksin, ya, dengan dos yang sama seperti mana dos orang dewasa, iaitu 0.3 ml, dua doses sekurang-kurangnya 3 minggu empat, ya, 3 minggu 4. Ini adalah dos yang dipakai di seluruh dunia kerana kajian klinikal yang membuktikan keberkesanan dan keselamatan dos yang diberikan, ya. Dan terakhir, rekomendasi kita adalah memastikan, mengatakan bahawa kita tidak perlu memberikan rawatan ubat untuk demam dan juga untuk sakit sebelum mengambil vaksinasi, ya. Kita cadangkan supaya ubat itu boleh digunakan, tetapi digunakan sekiranya mempunyai penerima mengalami demam ataupun sakit selepas vaksinasi, ya. Jadi seperti saya terangkan tadi bahawa kanak-kanak dan remaja kurang mendapat COVID-19 yang teruk, tapi ada sebilangan mereka yang boleh mendapat jangkitan yang serius. Dan juga ada satu condition untuk kanak-kanak yang kita kenali sebagai multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children. Yang ini very specific untuk kanak-kanak. Jangkitan ini juga kurang berlaku tapi amat serius sekiranya ia berlaku. Dan di negara kita telah ada kes-kes yang semikian yang berlaku apabila mereka mendapat jangkitan COVID-19 dan komplikasi dengan mendapat MISC. Ya. Dan yang kita juga melihat trend terakhir seperti mana di seluruh dunia, di mana bilangan kanak-kanak dan remaja yang mendapat COVID telah meningkat dengan begitu mendadak, ya. Saya rasa kita dah mengetahui dan ada data-data yang telah dikongsikan bersama oleh pihak kementerian di mana peningkatan kes yang amat mendadak. Saya boleh sebutkan di sini bahawa pada tahun lepas kita mempunyai sebanyak 12,620 kes di kalangan kanak-kanak bawah 18 tahun dengan 6 kematian, dan sehingga Ogos peningkatan kes yang begitu mendadak kepada pada 310,000 kes, ya, dengan 41 kematian. Walaupun figure ini, kematian ini jauh lebih rendah daripada apa yang berlaku di kalangan dewasa, tapi bilangan ini meningkat dengan mendadak, dan kita boleh menjangkakan apabila lebih ramai yang diberikan vaksinasi di kalangan orang dewasa, virus ini akan mencari mangsa-mangsa yang tidak mempunyai ketahanan badan, tidak mempunyai vaksinasi, dan kemungkinan besar kanak-kanak merupakan akan menjadi fokus kepada jangkitan seterusnya. Jadi amat penting untuk kita terus melaksanakan untuk melindungi anak-anak ini secepat mungkin, ya, dengan vaksin yang berkesan, ya. Jadi jadi bilangannya kes yang meningkat ini saya rasa bermula daripada bulan Julai dan Ogos dan September, dan mungkin berkaitan dengan varian Delta variant yang berlaku sekarang ini. Selain daripada itu, ya, bukan saja dari segi direct health impact kepada kanak-kanak dan remaja, kita tahu juga bagaimana besarnya impact yang indirect, ya, kepada remaja, kepada kanak-kanak dan remaja, terutama keluarga, terutama kepada persekolahan yang tak dapat diteruskan dan kehidupan mereka, mental and development. So these are huge impact on the child, eh? And then mungkin kita tak dapat balik, ya, eh? Tak dapat balik, they can never recover back what they lost over the last 1.5 years to 2 years, kan? Jadi these are huge impact that we have to take action. So one of it is vaccination, lah. Vaksinasi akan memberi kesan yang kesan yang besar, dan kita mengharapkan dengan vaksinasi di kalangan remaja juga kita akan dapat membawa mereka dan negara kita kembali kepada kehidupan yang normal, ya, dan balik kepada aktiviti yang asal. Baik. Jadi saya telah tekankan di sini grup-grup kumpulan-kumpulan yang mana diberikan penekanan, ya, yang kita tahu sebilangan besar daripada kanak-kanak mempunyai underlying medical condition, ya, seperti mana orang dewasa juga, all these condition seperti masalah paru-paru, jantung, kencing manis, buah pinggang, masalah neurologi dan sebagainya, obesity, mereka meningkatkan risiko remaja dan juga kanak-kanak untuk mendapat COVID yang lebih serius, ya. Jadi kita tekankan kepada kumpulan ini untuk diberikan. Maksudnya kalau ada sekarang di kumpulan ini dah berumur 12 hingga 17 tahun yang berada di rumah di mana-mana sekalipun, kita nak pastikan mereka lah yang dulu yang patut mendapat vaksinasi, ya, sebelum diberikan kepada remaja yang lain, ya. Okey, ini adalah table menunjukkan kumpulan-kumpulan penyakit yang boleh diberikan keutamaan untuk diberikan vaksinasi. Untuk sebagai jasa untuk tatapan, ya. Jadi vaksin apakah yang diberikan kepada remaja? Currently the only approved vaccine ialah Pfizer vaccine, ya. Pfizer vaccine sebab telah ditunjukkan dengan clinical trials yang strong clinical trials that it is safe. It produce antibodies and they are very efficacious. Maksud efficacious meaning they have very effective in adolescence, yeah, specific for adolescence. And now daripada beberapa bulan yang terakhir ini kita tahu kita have real world data juga daripada banyak negara-negara yang telah melaksanakan program imunisasi di kalangan remaja, lebih daripada 20 negara di seluruh dunia, menunjukkan keberkesanan dan keselamatan dari segi pemberian vaksin COVID-19 di kalangan remaja menggunakan Pfizer vaksin, ya. Jadi kontraindikasi adalah sama seperti yang dewasa. Jadi tidak banyak perbezaan dari segi pelaksanaan vaksinasi, kontraindikasi, keselamatan dan sebagainya. Saya cuma nak tekankan sekali lagi dari segi kita juga menyarankan mengadakan assessment pre-vaccination untuk sebilangan kecil kanak-kanak remaja ini, dan kanak-kanak ini perlu di-assess ataupun diberi penilaian terlebih dahulu sebelum sama ada mereka sesuai untuk menerima vaksin, bila dan di mana. Dan kerana mereka mempunyai risiko-risiko tertentu. Sebenarnya pre-vaccination assessment ini adalah sama seperti yang telah dijalankan dengan orang-orang dewasa yang lain. Tiga kumpulan utama ialah mereka yang immunocompromised, mereka mempunyai masalah pendarahan dan juga mereka mempunyai alergi, perlu dinilai dahulu oleh pegawai-pegawai perubatan sebelum kita memberikan appointment untuk vaksinasi. Consent saya seperti mana bawah daripada 18 tahun memerlukan consent daripada ibu bapa dan saya rasa akan dibincangkan selepas ini. Dan saya cuma ingin terakhir sekali menekankan pada isu yang selalu timbul dalam media dan juga di dalam social media dan sebagainya mengenai isu vaksinasi dan keselamatan Pfizer vaksin. Ya. Sebenarnya memang ada laporan-laporan mengenai kesan sampingan seperti masalah jantung seperti myocarditis dan pericarditis yang dilaporkan selepas penerimaan vaksin mRNA COVID-19 ya, sama ada Pfizer ataupun Moderna. Kes yang berlaku adalah di kalangan remaja lelaki dan juga orang dewasa yang kurang daripada 30 tahun di kalangan lelaki. Kebiasaannya pada selepas dos kedua dan simptom ini biasanya akan timbul dalam masa satu minggu pertama selepas vaksinasi. Ya. Tetapi sebenarnya bilangan kes yang berlaku ini adalah amat kecil. Ini disebabkan oleh very strong, robust surveillance system yang dilakukan di seluruh negara untuk melihat kesan-kesan sampingan ini dapat mengenalpasti kes-kes myocarditis dan yang pericarditis yang berlaku. Ya. Kes yang dilaporkan sebenarnya kurang daripada 0.01% daripada yang menerima vaksinasi. Ya. Jadi bilangan ini kecil. Ya. Kalau kita sekarang ini banyak juga kajian telah menunjukkan bahawa risiko mendapat COVID-19 myocarditis selepas mendapat sekiranya mendapat jangkitan COVID-19 adalah jauh lebih tinggi ya berbanding dengan mendapat masalah myocarditis pericarditis selepas vaksinasi COVID-19 ya risikonya jauh lebih tinggi ya. Jadi dan walau bagaimanapun ini adalah sesuatu yang kita mesti pantau dengan sebaik-baiknya kerana ia sesuatu yang kita tidak ingin melihat berlaku kepada anak-anak remaja kita dan anak-anak kita ya. Jadi sebenarnya kita Kementerian Kesihatan akan memantau dengan begitu rapilah semua pemberian vaksin COVID-19 di kalangan remaja dan kita ada algoritma ataupun carta ahli dan sebagainya untuk memastikan semua kes-kes itu dapat dikesan dan dapat diinvestigate ataupun dibuat ujian yang sepatutnya dan diberikan rawatan yang sepatutnya. Setakat data yang kita terima daripada seluruh dunia yang telah memantau pada ini adalah kebanyakan kes adalah kes-kes yang dilaporkan ini adalah ringan ya, jalannya adalah ringan ya dan dia responded well to medication and rest ya. Dia tak memerlukan rawatan-rawatan yang tinggi dan rawatan-rawatan yang simple dan mereka recover dengan cepatnya ya. Tapi data-data jangka masa panjang masih lagi dikumpulkan. Jadi untuk makluman semua juga apakah tanda-tanda apakah yang perlu dilihat ya ataupun diberikan peringatan dari segi tanda-tanda myocarditis dan pericarditis simple one macam chest pain ya sakit dada susuka bernafas sesak nafas ya ataupun rasa palpitation itu rasa macam berdebar-debar ataupun denyutan jantung yang kuat ya. Itu tanda-tanda yang something yang kita akan maklumkan supaya kepada semua yang menerima vaksin supaya mereka akan pastikan mereka kenal pasal tanda-tanda berikut dan memberi maklum kepada petugas kesihatan dan datang mendapatkan rawatan sekiranya benda ini berlaku ya. Kemungkinan ini disebabkan oleh faktor-faktor lain ya, bukan semestinya semua yang punya tanda-tanda ini adalah mempunyai masalah jantung. Setengahnya adalah boleh disebabkan oleh penyakit-penyakit lain ya. Jadi we advise that they seek medical care at the nearest health clinics, especially if within the first week of receiving the vaccine. Ya, dan maklumkan juga bahawa dah menerima vaksin atau tunjukkan My Sejahtera, ya, vaksin COVID yang diterima tersebut, dan doktor akan memeriksa dan akan do the further test and provide appropriate management and treatment. Ya, untuk petugas-petugas kesihatan kita telah mengadakan tata ahli yang jelas untuk mereka dan memberikan training dan education kepada mereka untuk how to deal bila ada sekiranya ada penerima vaksin yang mempunyai tanda-tanda tertentu dan tidak pasti mendapatkan rawatan dan kita akan akan dibuat pemeriksaan dan juga ujian selanjutnya dan juga rawatan-rawatan yang sepatutnya. Jadi sebenarnya saya rasa itu saja. Sebenarnya rawatan myocarditis dan pericarditis sebenarnya adalah satu, sememangnya adalah satu risiko, tapi risikonya adalah amat rendah dan kebanyakan kes adalah ringan dan dapat dan sembuh dengan sepenuhnya. Secara keseluruhannya saya rasakan bahawa evidence yang ada sekarang ini menunjukkan bahawa program vaksinasi di kalangan remaja amat diperlukan untuk negara kita dengan bilangan kes yang meningkat begitu mendadak. Dan saya jangkakan untuk banyak benefit-benefit lain yang ataupun kelebihan lain yang kita dapat sekiranya vaksinasi ini teruskan, ya. Selain daripada benefit kepada remaja itu sendiri dari segi mengurangkan risiko mendapat COVID yang serius, mendapat masalah-masalah kesihatan yang lain seperti long COVID, masalah MISC yang saya sebutkan tadi, juga masalah-masalah dari segi social, schooling, education dan sebagainya. Dan juga membantu kita, negara kita untuk mencapai tahap immunity yang lebih tinggi untuk protect everyone. We have to vaccinate the remaja kerana dia akan meningkatkan immunity di peringkat negara. Ya, jadi kanak-kanak adalah lebih kurang 28% daripada bilangan penduduk Malaysia. Jadi sekiranya kita tidak vaksinate siapa yang layak untuk vaksinate di kalangan mereka, maka kita akan sentiasa mengalami masalah dari segi COVID outbreak di negara kita untuk jangka masa yang lama. Itu saja untuk dari segi pembentangan saya. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih Dr. Nick Harudin. Maybe I can should invite Dr. Zulkifli Ismail, ya, pakar perunding kanak-kanak dan juga pakar perunding pediatric cardiology. Can you give us some words to this effect?
Masih.
Sebelum kita open Q&A. Okay, Dr. Zul.
Yeah, terima kasih, Dr. Thank you. We all understand that in the beginning, the Ministry of Health was very cautious about introducing the vaccine to adolescents. And that's very understandable with the initial data that came out. Tapi sekarang ni we have more data and we know that although myocarditis is one of the features that occur, which is very rare, but if you get COVID, the risk is like this. The risk of getting myocarditis with Pfizer second dose in a boy is about 1 in 20,000. But your risk of getting myocarditis if you get infected with COVID for the same age is 1 in 3,000. So we weigh everything together, it is of more benefit to actually get the vaccine for the teenagers. And rightly so, the ministry was very cautious in the beginning, and that's why there was a bit of a turnaround when the ministry first started to introduce. And now is probably the right time for us to actually start giving the vaccine to the teens, but especially for those with comorbidities and the obese ones. Thank you, Dr.
Okay, thanks, Dr. Zul. Dr. Benedict Sim from Sungai Buloh, can you share with us the experience in Sungai Buloh with regards to the number of patients? You know, I mean, the adults' number of admission to ICU and the severe cases have gone down dramatically. Maybe you can share with us the experience in Sungai Buloh, Ben.
Thanks, Datuk. I think we have seen the Sungai Buloh is just one of the government hospitals receiving COVID-19 patients now. Compared to the peak of our experiences, which was almost 2 months ago, about maybe 7 weeks ago, at that time we were seeing when we look at category 4 and 5 patients, it means patients who needed oxygen, and we were seeing up to 120 cases a day coming in with of patients needing that kind of support. Now we are seeing the same numbers, about 120 in a week. So this is of over the last couple of weeks data. So the number of severe cases has dropped quite dramatically, like 6-7 fold, and I think Klang Valley has got very high rates of vaccination. So we are still seeing in fact I think from the figures Klang Valley rates of vaccination is almost 100% now for adults, and we are seeing about half of the patients coming in now with severe infections, they have been vaccinated. The other half is not vaccinated yet. On the surface, it may look quite alarming why the vaccinated population are also getting severe disease, up to half of them being vaccinated. But if we take the denominator, or we consider that almost 100% of people in Klang Valley have been vaccinated already, the proportion that are coming in with severe disease after vaccination is much, much lower than those who are not vaccinated. And we're also seeing an increase in the younger age groups that have not been vaccinated yet. I think among our teenagers, admissions in over the last July and August, it accounted for about 1+% of our admissions were teenagers. In September, over the first 3 weeks of September, it had gone up to 3% of our admissions in the adolescent age group. So there is a steady increase in admissions among those who are not vaccinated. And so I think we are beginning to see that shift happening. Thanks.
Okay, thanks Ben for that information. Jadi kita buka kepada soalan-soalan daripada rakan media kita regarding vaksinasi remaja ni. Ada apa soalan daripada media? If you could raise your...
Yes, Dr. Ankanmani again from Kozu. I have three questions this time regarding the adolescents vaccination. The first question is, according to the American Academy of Pediatrics and the Children's Hospital Association, severe illness due to COVID-19 is uncommon among children. So why should we channel the vaccines to children first when we haven't fully inoculated all adults in the country?
Okay, we are not doing this vaccination for children first. We have been vaccinating adults. If you remember that we started to start vaccinating adolescent when the adult rates has breached 80%. That is when we start vaccinating children. And when we start vaccinating children, I think the high priority would be the ones who are having comorbidities. In fact, we have instructed our PPV special young in hospitals to begin vaccinating adolescent and children above 12 with high risk group. As what was shown by Dr. Nick Khairuddin just now, there are about 14 category of children whom we have started giving vaccination since earlier on. So these are high risk category of patients we have started to give vaccination. But once the adult population have received vaccination and we notice that the number of cases, severe cases in adults have declined, and then we are starting to see death in children. Death in children is equivalent to maybe many adults, you know, because the potential for children to live long is so much higher. So one children may be probably equivalent to about 5 adults. One death in children to us, I'm a pediatrician, I consider them, many, many times more. So if we can save one child, meaning that we can save a very long life ahead of them. So there is this, emphasis on why is it that we want to protect our children as well. So having said that, we started vaccinating children after the adults have reached a certain level of vaccination. Then we start to consider vaccinating children, the high risk groups first. Then now that we are seeing a lot of our kids are getting COVID-19. So that's our concern. So it is not done, without regard to the safety of our children. And looking at the data, the vaccines among children are even better. I mean, the safety profile is better among children compared to among adults. So that's our findings from the real world data as well as from the registration trial of the vaccine itself. Yeah. Maybe Dr. Nick can add into that, or Dr. Nick, can you?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, yes, Dato. I think I agree with that what Dato has mentioned before. I think we look at the priority is always adults, because of the higher risk of them dying from the or severe COVID from the infection. But we cannot expect to be able to vaccinate all adults, because there will be those who are contraindicated to have received the vaccine, those who totally refuse for vaccination. And because of that, we have to start vaccinating others once we reach certain levels of adult population. So I think the priority is definitely still adults, and we are going. I think the KKM is continue to vaccinate whichever adults that we have not reached can so far. But we have to start looking at children, because the numbers are scary, and we cannot wait too long before it becomes like an adult data, like at the beginning of the pandemic. We are already seeing that with the number of cases over the last 2-3 months. Increased by, I think, something like the last 2 months, something like 50 to 60,000 per month of children less than 18 years have been infected. And the numbers of patients in the hospital also now has increased as well, which we didn't see last year. So I think the data is there. I think US is also doing that now. The number of severe one is not that many, but it is increasing rapidly. So I think we should be doing it together, that we continue to vaccinate the older, the adults as well, but it's time also to move on with the younger children because they are at risk as well.
Yeah, Dr. Zul, any input on that?
Yeah,
is it justifiable to vaccinate children?
Kamani, I think what you referred to, the American Academy of Pediatrics paper is true. But then if we look at the infection rate here in this country, the children now have, I think, about 25 times more this year compared to last year. So there is a shift in the disease from the older to the younger people. And I think this Delta variant is probably responsible for it. So I think as Hisham Shah has said, this is the right time to do it. And we have already achieved that level for the adults. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. My second question is based on Dr. Nick and Dr. Zulkifli's answer. Does this mean vaccinating the adult population will protect the kids? Because in US, a drop in COVID-19 cases among adults eventually reduced COVID-19 cases among children too. So can we expect the same pattern in Malaysia?
Well, we are seeing, I mean, the number of cases drops for all categories. For the adults, among the vaccinated, of course, the number of cases drop. But correspondingly, I'm not sure. Dr. Nick, I mean, the data shows that we are seeing a lot more children with COVID-19, versus US.
Yes, I think it definitely that the number we've seen is very, very high. I think it has to do with the Delta variant now, that we assume is a Delta variant, most predominant one, and that the infection rate with the Delta variant being like one in one will infect eight, you know, are not of around eight, like chickenpox. Previously, it was only 1 in 2, and so on. So definitely, we will need to vaccinate a lot of people. And I think now we're talking more of population immunity rather than adult number immunity, because it's not going to be enough that we just vaccinate the adult and expecting it's full protecting the young children. That previously, that was the thought, that maybe we don't need to vaccinate the children. We might get away by vaccinating enough adults, then we protect the whole children. But I think the picture is different now. Maybe we can still get some benefits from vaccinating the adults, the majority of adults vaccinated, but it will not really fully protect the children as we expect before with this new, very more transmissible form of Delta variant that we face now. So yes, we can reduce probably the higher number of adults being vaccinated and less number of children being infected compared to those population where the number of adults vaccinated is lower, but we will not achieve the same numbers of protection as we expected before. So I think that will not be enough to say that you vaccinate enough adults that we are going to be protecting our kids, not with this new Delta variant that we are seeing. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Doctor.
I just interject, Doctor. We'll share the figures of increasing numbers on children shortly in the chat box so they can refer to the data there.
Yeah.
Dr. Amir on the call, Datuk, maybe he can also.
Yeah, okay, please. Dr. Amir, our pediatric immunologist, Amir, we can't hear you.
Yes, sorry. Thanks, Datuk. Now, I think I was impressed hearing the whole conversation, right? And we have moved away from this herd immunity story because this has been implicated from some time ago. And I think, but at the same time, I think it's worthwhile revisiting that term. Because if you look at what Dr. Nick has mentioned, if you look at I too do believe that the Delta variant is the game changer here, right? And the fact that infectivity is more with the R naught of 8. And if you look at as well as the probably the incubation period is also shorter and the virus shedding is more. So that there are a lot of things that needs to be said about that. But if you look at, let's say, measles, right? If you look at the herd immunity that we need to achieve for that, that's about 93% of the population. So obviously now here, and this was always going to be the case, the minute we have almost all the adults going to be immunized, then you'll know that there will be a shift to the younger age group, right? And this is exactly what's happening, and it's pretty much obvious that we will need to have to address this. And that's what we are doing. I think the ministry is addressing and looking at it very carefully. At the same time, we are always continuing things in the background. I share the same view. So if you look at that, and if you think that 93%, of course, we are not going to be as high, I think, for the SARS-CoV-2, but we wouldn't know, right? What is the number? So the more we now vaccinate the population, I think the safer that we're going to say that we'll probably be more likely to come out of the pandemic. So I think that's my simple view at this point. Thank you, Dato.
Okay, thanks, Amir, for that view. Yeah, because we are seeing the changing pattern. I mean, the dynamic of the pandemic has shifted now that the virus is becoming more transmissible and the R-naught is, as you say, you know, it can infect 8. And vaccinating the adults is not enough anymore. Our kids are now getting COVID-19 and they're dying. Last year, there's only a total number of 6. Now we are seeing about how many? A lot more. So that is why we consider that this is about the time where we really need to consider vaccinating our kids. Having said that, we are going to probably do it in a very cautious manner. We are putting, what do you call it, everything in place to make sure that this is going to be done judiciously and making sure that all adverse events are going to be catered to, and we are going to make sure that none of our kids are going to be affected badly by any adverse event. So that's why we have been, training our people on the ground to look out for all of these subtle signs and symptoms of pericarditis and myocarditis. Although it is reversible and most are mild, but we are still cautious. I wanted to make sure that this would not affect our adolescent adversely. So we take note on that, and we are cognizant on the issues that you have brought up. Okay, any other question before we move to Dr. Saidato to advise us on how is the pelaksanaan? Okay, last question from Fong Fong, yeah?
Yes, that's right. Hi. Yeah. I would like to know whether any of the brought in dead cases, are there any link to blood clots or myocarditis or pericarditis in any way? Are there any such cases linked?
Okay, I don't have any what you call latest data on blood clots among BID or myocarditis. Kala, because you got any data on that you know of?
No, Dato. We don't have that specifically related to blood clots and BID. But certainly we can explore whether the mortality review, any of those has been reported. Thus far, I don't think any has been reported such.
Yes, I think a lot of data that we've shared in our GitHub, COVID now, with regards to I think Code Blue was asking about, the number of vaccinated individuals and the category. I think that is actually, previously it was given in the infographics by Tan Sri DG, but now it is all, put up in GitHub and in COVID now. You can check on that. I think the details are there. Before we move on to Dr. Saidato, let me anyone wants to ask verbally this question? Can I invite a last question from the press from regard to vaccinasi kanak-kanak, following on from Dr. Nick Karudin's question? This one is from Code Blue. Yeah. Is Malaysia just following other countries in rolling out boosters for elderly people, despite the lack of data on waning immunity, including in elderly? We are not talking about booster now. Yeah. I mean, now we are talking about vaccinating adolescent. But we are looking into this. I think probably when we have decided on this booster, when to start giving our people booster, we are going to probably you know, discuss on that matter. Apa ni? So because at the moment we are saying that we are doing adolescent, and then we are waiting for data for elderly for booster doses. Okay, we're going to probably
since the decision has been made about booster shot, so it means that for adolescents also there will be booster shots later, right? The decision is the same, right? Or adolescents no need for booster shot later.
Haris, I think although announcement have been made that we are considering booster shot, tapi we have not you know, decided when to start giving the booster shot. At the moment, we are considering several category of people that's going to be considered for booster shot. Yeah, but then when exactly? I think maybe Dr. Sainatul can advise me on whether have we made any decision on that. When exactly? We have not, but I know that we have considered giving booster shot, meaning the third dose for immunocompromised patient, and the other category would be people with comorbidities. Yeah. That would require a certain level of protection, and the third one is actually people who are, you know, at risk, high risk cases where people like, you know, the frontliners who are exposed to the virus, you know, constantly. So those would be the category of people that we are going to give considering booster shot, but I think the details have not been you know, finalized. Maybe I think we can get back to that after Dr. Sainatul give us a briefing on vaksinasi, proses vaksinasi di kalangan remaja. Yeah, can we hear Dr. Sainatul, and maybe she can probably update us on that, Dr. Sainatul? Okay, thank you. Tak dengar. Dr. Sainatul,
okay. Boleh dengar tak sekarang?
Boleh.
Okay, sorry. Okay, terima kasih Datuk. Apa yang ingin saya bentangkan lebih kepada proses, ya, bagaimana pelaksanaan vaksinasi dengan kalangan remaja. Apabila kita kata remaja dalam konteks ini, kita hanya merujuk kepada mereka yang berumur 12 hingga 17 tahun sahaja, ya. Okay, apabila kita kata vaksinasi untuk remaja ini, kita merujuk kepada vaksinasi akan jalankan di sekolah, ya, sama ada sekolah kerajaan maupun swasta. Vaksinasi akan jalankan dalam institusi, ya, perlindungan, contohnya seperti rumah anak-anak yatim, ya, institusi pemulihan macam Taman Sri Puteri ataupun kita kata rumah bakti. Mahupun juga di dalam penjara ataupun dikata institusi penjagaan OKU jangka panjang. Kemudian kita juga akan jalankan vaksinasi di klinik swasta, ya. Dan yang terbaru pada hari ini, ya, semalam telah dimaklumkan bahawa vaksinasi akan dilaksanakan pusat-pusat pemberian vaksin yang masih beroperasi. Maksudnya pusat-pusat vaksinasi yang sekarang sedang memberi vaksinasi kepada golongan remaja, ya. Saya akan bercakap tentang vaksinasi di sekolah ini sedikit masa lagi, ya, dan juga di PV sikit lagi. Untuk di institusi, ya, manakan mereka ini dimasukkan ke dalam institusi di bawah akta-akta, maka pemberian kepada mereka ini, Kementerian Kesihatan akan pergi ke institusi dan memberi mereka vaksinasi, ya. Dan bagi mereka yang bersekolah, ya, kita ada dua option, sama ada kita buat di sekolah mahupun di PPV, ya. Sebenarnya Kementerian Kesihatan, ya, kita mensasarkan 3.2 juta remaja dapat divaksinasikan sehingga akhir lengkap dua dos pada akhir Disember 2021 ya, dengan sasaran kita 80% ya akan mendapat dos lengkap pada Disember inilah ya. Sebab sebagaimana dewasa kita ada juga reason setengah kanak-kanak ini tidak mungkin dapat kita beri sebanyak 100%. Sebab pada hari ini ya kita dapati apabila kita mula membuka PPV awam dan integrasi, walaupun semalam telah dimaklumkan kaedah-kaedah pelaksanaan, tetapi dapati ada juga ibu bapa menyerbu PPV ya tanpa sebarang temu janji. Jadi di sini saya ingin terangkan ya istilah ya dalam konteks remaja ini kita vaksinasi remaja ini di pusat pemberian vaksin ya kita menggunakan istilah vaksinasi berjadual ya. Ada tiga kaedah ya. Satu vaksinasi berjadual, yang kedua vaksinasi secara temu janji, yang ketiga secara pure walk-in. So biar saya terangkan dulu tentang vaksinasi berjadual ya. Maksud vaksinasi berjadual ini adalah di mana?
Screen ya. Screen show. Besarkan your screen.
Oh sorry. Okay. Macam mana screen show?
Tak show.
Tak show. Hold on. Oh yeah, hold on. Let me. Mana dia? Tak gerak. Tak gerak. Naik. Kejap mouse. Mouse tak gerak. Okay, kejap. Apa maksud vaksinasi berjadual ini? Bermaksud di belakang tabirnya ya, apa yang berlaku, pejabat kesihatan daerah dan pejabat pendidikan daerah kedua-duanya duduk dan menetapkan ya di sesebuah PPV ini sekolah mana yang akan pergi. Jadi jadual yang akan diberi ini adalah jadual kepada pihak sekolah. Dia bukan jadual kepada ibu bapa bila kita kata vaksinasi berjadual ni tadi. Jadi pihak dengan persetujuan kedua-dua pejabat kesihatan daerah dan pejabat pendidikan ni tadi, kita menjadikan satu jadual dan jadual bagi setiap PPV ini diserahkan kepada pihak sekolah ya. Dan sekolah yang akan maklumkan kepada ibu bapa jadual vaksinasi sekolah. Ya, bagi kategori vaksinasi berjadual ini, murid ataupun ibu bapa tidak akan menerima temu janji melalui MySejahtera sama sekali. Jadi dalam konteks vaksinasi berjadual ini, ia adalah khususkan untuk murid sekolah harian, ya, murid sekolah pendidikan khas harian, sekolah swasta dan antarabangsa kita masukkan dalam kategori ini ya. Dan mereka yang telah mendapat janji temu melalui sekolah ini, mereka perlulah pergi ke lokasi yang telah ditetapkan ya. Ya, andai kata mereka menerima temu janji lain, kita tidak membenarkan adalah terbatal ya. Mereka perlu pergi ke temu janji sama ada di PPV ataupun sekolah yang ditetapkan dalam jadual tersebut. So dalam konteks ini ya, ibu bapa perlu menyemak jadual vaksinasi sekolah ya. Sekiranya nama sekolah anak belum keluar lagi, kita mohon supaya ibu bapa menghubungi pihak sekolah, bukan hubung KKM ya, kerana KKM tidak tahu jadual vaksinasi setiap sekolah. Dan ibu bapa kita mohon membawa anak mengikut tarikh, tempat dan masa yang telah ditetapkan dalam jadual ya. Dan kita mohon ya, kerana mereka sebagaimana Dr. Nick katakan tadi, kerana mereka berada di bawah 18 tahun, ibu bapa perlu menandatangani borang persetujuan vaksinasi ya. Dan sekiranya mereka tidak dapat hadir, ibu bapa atau penjaga yang sah ni tadi perlu mewakilkan ya kepada orang dewasa berumur 18 tahun untuk membawa anak mereka ke tempat vaksinasi. Di sini kita mohon ya agar ibu bapa atau penjaga salah seorang ya daripada dewasa hadir untuk tiga sebab. Yang pertama untuk mengetahui ya, sama ada pada hari temu janji ini tadi boleh tak remaja ini disuntik, adakah ia sihat untuk disuntik. Yang kedua sekiranya ya, sebagaimana kita tahu vaksin mungkin ada kesan sampingannya sama ringan, sederhana, kita perlu sekiranya perlu petugas kesihatan ingin melakukan intervensi terhadap kanak-kanak tersebut, kita perlu ada satu orang dewasa yang boleh memberikan persetujuan untuk intervensi dilakukan. Yang ketiganya, kita tidak mahu remaja ini selepas divaksinasi, selepas dilepaskan oleh pusat pemberian vaksinasi di sekolah ataupun PPV, berjalan seorang balik rumah. Kita mahu ada orang dewasa yang mengawasi kanak-kanak tersebut. Ya. Dan sekiranya akhir sekali kita minta ibu bapa, ya, apabila anak dia tidak boleh hadir mengikut jadual ditetapkan, perlu maklum kepada pihak sekolah, ya, kerana apabila mereka tidak hadir, remaja yang ini kita dalam kategori ini kita beri temu janji baru melalui Mas Sejahtera, dan kemungkinan tempat yang akan divaksinasi sama ada di klinik kesihatan mahupun di klinik swasta, ya, kerana apabila mereka terlepas temu janji, jadual sekolah mereka telah terlepas. Jadi untuk memudahkan mereka, kita hantar mereka ke klinik swasta ataupun ke klinik kesihatan, ya, melalui Mas Sejahtera tadi. Kedua kategorinya adalah mereka yang pergi dengan janji temu, ya. Ini kita khususkan untuk pelajar asrama penuh dan asrama harian serta sekolah pendidikan khas yang ada asrama, tak kira lah sama ada sekolah asrama kerajaan mahupun swasta, ya. Kenapa keputusan ini dibuat bagi janji temu bagi pulih asrama? Kerana kita tahu pada masa ini sekolah ditutup dan kita ingin mempercepatkan mereka mendapat vaksinasi. So sementara, ya, sekolah ini ditutup, mereka akan diberi janji temu vaksinasi di PPV atau sekolah dekat dengan kediaman mereka, ya. Mereka sekiranya berlaku keadaan mana tersilap beri, ya, ada insiden yang berlaku di mana pelajar mendapat vaksinasi di kawasan sekolah, mohon maklumkan semula untuk kita perbetulkan, ya. So pada masa ini untuk kategori ini budak asrama penuh dan harian, vaksinasi mereka adalah berdekatan dengan rumah mereka. Yang ini tak, ibu bapa tak perlu tengok jadual. They have to check the child either theirs or their children My Sejahtera application for the appointment, ya. Yeah? So in this context it's slightly different. Parents, ya, yeah, kita tanggungjawabnya perlulah mendaftarkan anak through dependents dalam My Sejahtera apps, and if the child do have their own mobile phone, the child can register in their My Sejahtera apps as well. Yeah. Okay, then in this instance, khususnya, ya, if the parents, ya, duduk di luar negara ataupun parents yang duduk di luar negeri, ya, mereka boleh menandatangani borang kebenaran dan menghantar secara fax ataupun email ataupun melalui WhatsApp kepada pihak sekolah, ya, ataupun sekolah, kepada wakil yang akan membawa anak tadi ke pusat vaksinasi, ya. In this context, kita tahu some parents will not be able to come, but we need them to sign the consent form. Kerana walaupun mereka tidak ada bersama anak, tanggungjawab memberi consent masih jatuh kepada ibu bapa. And in this instance, these parents perlu juga menyertakan authority letter to those who's going to represent them and bring the child to the vaccination site center. Yeah. Again, similarly, those who cannot attend on whatever reason, they need to inform the school so that we can provide them with a new appointment through My Sejahtera. And if they can't do it, they can inform the teacher ataupun they can inform the PKD for help. Okay, the last group would be the walk-in group. This is where the adolescent that boleh berjalan masuk ke mana-mana PPV ataupun di PPV yang sedang memberi vaksinasi. Ini adalah dikategorikan di mana remaja yang berada dalam IPTA or IPTS, ya. Kami mendapati ada juga remaja sebenarnya mereka tak layak diberi vaksinasi sebagai orang dewasa because they are not, although they are born in the year mereka umur 18 tahun, and yet they are not 18. dan mereka juga tidak tergolong dalam golongan 17 tahun dan ke bawah. And for those dalam kategori ini, mereka boleh bergerak ke mana-mana PPB dalam Malaysia. Yeah? For kategori pertama, they can walk to any PPB dalam Malaysia. Untuk pelajar IPTA, IPTS, mereka hanya perlu menunjukkan their student card. Yeah? Dan mereka boleh mendapatkan vaksinasi dengan syarat juga kerana mereka di bawah 18 tahun, they still need their parental consent and they have to walk to PPV yang ada vaksin Pfizer, community of Pfizer sahaja, yeah? Because only community has been approved for below 18. Yeah? Other group yang boleh walk in adalah remaja yang tidak bersekolah. Ya. Maknanya those not schooling termasuklah juga remaja yang menjalankan homeschooling. Ya. So these are the number 2 dan number 3 ini adalah true category yang kita benarkan untuk walk in. Ya. Dari segi the parents is still the same criteria. Ya. So please for the media, I would like to request your help to inform the parents, janganlah serbu mana-mana PPV tanpa sebarang temu janji. Ya. They have to wait for the appointment from school and we have Kementerian Kesihatan vaksin yang mencukupi untuk golongan remaja. Tidak seperti mana semasa kita melaksanakan vaksinasi untuk adult pada masa dulu, kita vaksin kita tak cukup. Ya. Tetapi sekarang kita mempunyai vaksin yang cukup dan kita akan memberi vaksinasi kepada semua remaja. That means that we are trying to reach as much as possible the 3.2 million di dalam negara ini, irrespective of their citizenship status. I think saya berhenti di sini saja, Datuk Pengerusi.
Okay, terima kasih, Dr. Sairatul. Any question from the media with regards to ni proses pemberian vaksinasi di kalangan remaja? I think I hope people can inform that bukan walk-in, ya, hanya vaksinasi berjadual kan untuk remaja. Yang walk-in tu only certain kategori saja.
Hello.
Yes.
Joseph from the Star. Yeah, sorry, I tak tahu macam mana nak raise hand, so okay. Mencelah je. Okay. Saya nak tanya Dr. Sairatul, because we had our reporters pergi ke Bukit Jalil punya PPV today, and then dia diberitahu daripada PPV sana that dia dapat surat walk-in telah dibatalkan. Dia kata macam tu. So understand that today is when you start the walk-ins for all those yang tidak bersekolah, mereka yang layak untuk walk-in. So so this thing mungkin dia ada apa ni? Sorry. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So okay. sebab tadi surat yang kita dapat tu, hang on lah, daripada your bahagian lah, bagi pihak your bahagian.
Okay, right. Sebenarnya tuan, itu bukanlah surat untuk orang awam. Surat yang diterima itu adalah surat dalaman kepada Jabatan Kesihatan Negeri untuk membuat persediaan, ya, yang tidak ada kena mengena langsung dan tidak sepatutnya berada di tangan orang awam, ya. Dan sebenarnya itu sebagai persediaan, ya, kita membatalkan, ya, surat itu juga bukan untuk orang awam. Kita batalkan untuk negeri kerana keputusan telah dibuat untuk membuat vaksinasi secara berjadual. Isunya adalah apabila ibu bapa memegang surat Kementerian Kesihatan dalaman untuk dijadikan bahan bukti boleh bergerak kepada PPV. Semalam jelas, ya, kalau kita ada PC antara Timbalan Menteri Pendidikan 1 dan Timbalan Menteri Kesihatan 1, ya, menjelaskan inilah 3 kaedah saja yang boleh dilaksanakan di PPV, ya, dan tidak semua, ya, untuk pengetahuan tuan, tidak semua PPV akan menerima remaja, ya, tidak semua, ya, hanya ada lebih 156 PPV ataupun integrasi dan awam yang telah dipilih untuk membolehkan pemberian vaksinasi kepada golongan remaja buat masa ini. dan kemungkinan bilangan ini akan bertambah. Kita akan cuba mohon mendapat keputusan untuk bertambahlah ya. Dan tak silap saya, untuk PPV di Bukit Jalil tidak diluluskan untuk pemberian vaksinasi remaja kerana pada masa ini dia lebih bersifat untuk walk-in kepada bukan warga negara asing.
Oh, okey. Maknanya Bukit Jalil not one of it. Sebab saya ada senarai 156 PPV tu, letak di situ Bukit Jalil is one of the 156. So
the Aziata is it? Aziata is one of it.
Aziata di Bukit Jalil. So, oh okay. Sebab ini PPV awam Bukit. I mean Bukit Jalil is a different one. It's not.
A different. Yeah, okay. Bukit Jalil is for adult yang masih menjalankan vaksinasi. Walk in untuk warga negara asing.
Okay. Understood. So, yang 156 tu memang hari ini dah boleh bermula lah ya.
Dia bermula
untuk yang layak walk in lah.
Dia tidak untuk walk in. Dia hanya untuk berjadual, sir. Where it means that the PPV has already set number of children that have been allocated by the school, yeah. And walk in hanya for those not schooling, homeschooling, or those IPTA or IPTS student at age 17 to 18, yeah.
Dan golongan ni not at the 156 PPV, yang golongan tak bersekolah, homeschooling.
They can go, yeah, in this 156 PPV as well.
Also can lah. So
can. Yeah. Right. Yeah, the problem that we face today, suddenly parents inform us semua anak dia orang tak sekolah.
Okay. Okay, satu lagi, bagaimana dengan school leavers? Mereka yang sudah habis, they are not 18 yet, they're turning 18, tapi dia dah habis sekolah. Jadi maknanya dia tak boleh, sekolah tak boleh nak inform dia sebab they're no longer part of that school. Tapi they're not IPTA student because dia tak masuk universiti. How about that?
Okay. For this group, they can walk to any PPV, sama dengan the IPTA study, they can walk to any PPVs in the country. Yeah, yang memberi vaksinasi Pfizer, and they bring in their parents and they sign a children punya consent form.
They it's fine if they don't show that they are apa ni?
It's fine. Yeah.
That's fine.
It's fine. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Soalan daripada Kirtan tu ada raise hand tu.
Tan. Yeah. Hi, doctor.
Yeah.
Doctor, I wanted to ask because just now, the doctor mentioned that we're trying to reach 100% vaccination for teenagers, irrespective of their citizenship status, right? I want to ask, what kind of efforts are we putting forward to perhaps invite or encourage children who may be from rural areas, who may not be going to school, or even children of illegal immigrants, or those even like we're having citizenship issues right now, so they may. You know, have like a Malaysian mother, but they can't get into school because of citizenship issues and so on. But especially rural areas and illegal immigrants, you know, how are we going to get them to come in?
Okay, thank you for the question, sir. With regards to, we call it as the hard to reach population, yeah. Similar to the adult approach, we're going to use almost similar approach. For example, the outreach approach, to the kampung, yeah. And with for orang asli, they ada they have actually their own task force to look for orang asli. And as some of this adult approach has not been completed, we would like to write on the same approach. Whenever, for example, for orang asli, they go in, kita kata we go in not only for adult, vaccinate the children as well. And if we go for the orang pulau, it's the same thing. And we actually for Ministry of Health, kami ada kita kata pasukan bergerak, yeah. Whenever dia akan masuk kampung, yeah. And through this mobile health services, kita akan beri servis kepada mereka di pendalaman. The biggest challenge would be those yang gelandangan dalam Kuala Lumpur, for example. Ini kami perlukan bantuan daripada NGO. Untuk mencapai kepada golongan remaja-remaja ini. For those kalau kata dalam tahanan di depo, kami bekerjasama dengan Jabatan Immigration untuk memberi vaksinasi kepada kumpulan ini ya. Dan sebagaimana adult, kita katakan untuk vaksinasi ini kita tidak mahu pihak berkuasa menggunakan dia kekerasan or penalty untuk menangkap mereka kalau mereka keluar. Yeah, we're going to use this kind of approach.
Okay, ada soalan lain untuk Dr. Sairatul?
Just curious, what about you saying about vaccinating teenagers dekat pedalaman, pulau-pulau dan orang asli? How do you determine their age for those who do not have proper documentation? For adults, we know lah, it's okay, but how do you determine they are suitable for a vaccine? And also some, you know, absence of medical records.
Yep. That, yes, I have to agree with you. That would be the biggest challenge, how to determine, because we really need them to be at the age of 12 before we can vaccinate them. Yeah, we cannot be, this is the biggest challenge that we have. So probably then we need to have confirmation from their, apa tu, the ketua kampung or their, whoever the leaders there to say their age. Yeah, if you, yeah.
I think our people on the ground are quite experienced with these people. Kita, we've been giving vaccination for more than 60 years. Sebelum merdeka lagi, Kementerian Kesihatan telah ditugaskan untuk memberi vaksinasi. I think there are ways and means for us to make sure we can assess whether are these people amenable or sesuai untuk diberi vaksin. I think we are going to probably try to get this difficult to reach people kan as best we could. Yeah. I think it's going to be a challenge, tapi I think they have experience. We have past experience of doing this, yeah. Ministry of Health memang kerja kita memang kita pentingkan pendalaman rural and underserved population. I think Dr. Sairatul pun naik helikopter pun pernah ya masuk ke dalam pedalaman dan sebagainya. Our people using boats dan kapal terbang, kita we will reach them wherever they are as best we could, yeah. We've been touched. Kita punya KPI 80% ya, Dr. Sairatul. By
80% by December.
So we're trying our best. It's challenging, I know. Tapi that's our job lah. Kita akan cuba sebaik right. mungkin.
Sorry, 80% KPI itu for the pendalaman
tu kan? You mentioned 80% by
December.
Okay. It means that kalau kita ada 3.2 million ni tadi, we should be able to reach 80% of them by December.
Is there any estimation how many of these 3.2 from the hard to reach group, or the 3.2 is yang ada dalam pencet saja, and hard to reach group is lain figure dia?
Yeah, okay. Kalau kita melihat ya, kebanyakan 12 hingga 17 tahun, they are in school, yeah. We would say around 10% would be within this hard to reach group, but that 10% at national level, but it differs if you go from state to state. For example, the most challenging would be Sabah, where Sabah have more immigrant than any other states.
Okay, Mr. Tan, lagi sekali ada soalan eh? I see a raised hand there. Kirtan,
yeah. Yeah, Kirtan. Okay, sorry. I got confused when you said Mr. Tan. Sorry, I'm backpacking just slightly here. But it was mentioned earlier that it's not recommended to take paracetamol for, you know, to try and prevent symptoms such as fever and things before going in for vaccinations, right? I was reading up some WHO guidelines that says the similar thing. But I was wondering if there's maybe, I'm just thinking that probably parents are going to be worried, and could there be any recommendations of what they can do if not taking something like paracetamol? What can they do to try and like avoid symptoms such as fever and so on?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for the questions. Yeah. Actually, paracetamol and NSAIDs, we say, for example, ibuprofen, is not. We're saying that it cannot be used at all. It can be used, but we suggest that it is used when they have the symptoms, we have the pain after the vaccination or when they have fever. So that will be more effective in terms of ameliorating the symptoms that they have. The concern why most of the guidelines says that we don't give paracetamol prophylactically or giving it before the vaccination or preventing the pain and fever is that it's just not just for COVID vaccine, it's for all other vaccines as well. It's just a concern that it may not work. We may not achieve the best benefits from the vaccination. But for by how much, we are also not so sure. So because of that, we say that try to be as best as possible, not to give before the vaccination, but give it after the vaccination if the child or the adolescents have the fever. Or have the pain that they have to deal with. So there are other ways for fever without the medications. For example, you can just give a sponging. You know, I have put tepid sponging on the body and so on to relieve. You can some people use cool fever, for example, to put it on. There are many other ways that you can try. But I will not say that it is totally contraindicated, but it's preferable to give the best. So that we will be able to get the best result from the vaccination, that we just hold on, wait until after the vaccination. And if they develop fever, yes, you can give the paracetamol for the fever or the pain relief. Thank you.
Okay, Cheryl from BFM, your question, please.
Hi, I just wanted to check, will there be any action taken against parents who may choose to not allow their children to be vaccinated, especially those who are, you know, immunocompromised or who are from a high-risk group?
Okay. Thank you for the question. For information, the vaccination is on voluntary basis. We do not mandate or make it mandatory to any parents. So it's up to the parents' decision whether the child to be vaccinated or not. Even let's say that if the parents agree or allow the child to be vaccinated, but at one end during the vaccine at the center, suddenly the child refused to be vaccinated, we will not give the vaccination as well. So both parents and child can say no to the vaccination. We do not mandate, but we encourage it 100% because the benefit being vaccinated is above being infected by COVID-19.
Dr. Zul is actually very experienced in vaccination. I mean, immunize for life. And I think as long as I can remember, you are in this initiative. Can you give some advice to everybody? I think a lot of parents here, you know.
Yeah. I think what Dr. Saidatul said is very true. We tried, as you remember, some time ago, we tried to make it mandatory. There was so much of opposition from people. So this is totally voluntary. So if the parents or the child decides not to have the vaccine, so be it. I mean, I don't think the government will punish them in any way. And what Dr. Saidatul has said is the truth, and that's how it should be. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. I mean, we are approaching 4:30. This is actually beyond. Initially, we thought sampai pukul 4. Yeah, a lot of us have got a few other meetings to attend. Any burning question from everyone? Besides Harissa, ada orang lain tak from other media? Kalau tak ada, kita pergi pada Haris. Okay, kalau tak ada, Haris, what will be your question now?
I just want to have update if there are how many companies so far have submitted vaccine dossier for under 18 to MPRA so far? Or only Pfizer je?
Under 18, ada MPRA sini tak? I know that Pfizer have submitted, and then of course daripada dulu is approved by Pfizer for 12 and above. I heard apa tu Sinovac, tapi Dr. Khaled, I mean anyone?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Yes, Sinovac has submitted for that purpose. They are looking at the moment, it's actually 12 to 17, not younger than that. So it's still in the process and the expert review panel. And so we'll have to wait and see what is the expert panel review submit to NPR. Yeah.
Okay. In fact, I think when we discussed with Pfizer, I think yesterday, last night, I mean, they are finalizing the 5 to 12 years old vaccine for COVID-19. It's a different formulation. I mean, dosing is, I think, about 10 micrograms or 5 micrograms. I think, about, I mean, much lower than the 30 micrograms for adults. Yeah, itu Pfizer vaccine yang for even 5 and above. Yeah, that is actually under review. Yeah. Fong, yeah.
Yes. Is there any concern with children exercising after vaccination? Should they refrain from exercising, say, for a week or something like that because of the heart issue problem? The risk of myocarditis and pericarditis. So are there any advice on that?
I think Dr. Nick, Dr. Zul.
Yeah,
I can answer that. There is advice. In fact, the advice is for anybody after the vaccination, after this COVID vaccination, to actually take a break for about a week.
Yeah.
It used to be about 3 days, 4 days, 5 days. Now for children, we advise them for a week to stay and not, because in the US, it's believed that the teens who got the myocarditis were the ones who actually got involved with activities after the vaccination. So it's a good thing to, for 2 days before and then for about a week after that, lay off all forms of activity. I hope that answers your question, Fong.
Yeah, yeah. The males, adolescent males especially, diorang ni, I mean, suruh relax 1 week.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Any question? Any burning question that you want to bring up? Otherwise, I'll go one round with the panelists. Kalau dia ada apa-apa concluding remarks. Dr. Kalai, anything else you wanted to say to the audience?
I'm fine, but the most important message still is the same, Dato. You must complete your vaccination dose as prescribed, including, of course, the teenagers who will be given the 2 doses. Because the best benefit comes out of the completion of the 2 doses. So fully vaccinated status is the best status. Thank you.
Yes, kalau 1 dose is not enough. Even from our data from local findings, I mean, the 1 dose is not enough, especially for the Delta. It wouldn't cover from preventing you to get infection. So that's our concern. So that's why we have adopted, even for the teenagers, 2 doses. Yeah. Okay, Kalai, and then Dr. Nick Harudin, anything else you want to add?
No, Dato, just to say that I very much encouraged the parents to get their kids vaccinated, you know, the teenagers vaccinated. COVID is not benign anymore for children, and we are seeing more and more cases, so prevent by getting vaccination.
Yeah, okay, I agree. That's our concern. We are looking at the data now, and for our country, we notice that this is happening. So that's why we need to make sure that our teenagers are protected as well. Dato' Zul, I know you're busy. Ada apa-apa nak sambah?
No, I think everything has been said already. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Benedict, Ben, anything from Sungai Buloh? Anything to add?
Maybe just from our press friends to help in the I think the it's always been mentioned the epidemic of fake news and misinformation. So I think the press has got a big role to play there, you know, especially when it comes to vaccination. Thanks.
Yeah, okay, because we don't want a pandemic amongst the unvaccinated, which is happening elsewhere. Yeah. Dr. Amir Hamzah, anything to add to the discussion?
No, Dato. I think I resonate with everybody and echo their views. And I personally would like to mention what Ben has already emphasized, right? And that is to give the correct, precise messaging and don't put it out of context. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Dr. Sairatul, anything? Booster belum decide lagi kan, Dr. Sairatul? Kita tak ada decide bagi booster kan?
We have not decided on the date when, and in term there are some discussion on who, but we still have to wait for top management decision. Okay, with regards to the I do agree with every panel saying that yes, the vaccination is important, but please we need the media help to inform us that to inform the parents basically do not rush and get the child to any PPVs. please wait for the appointment. We do not want any outbreak, yeah, among adolescents just because of their rush of their parents got rushing to the PPDs.
Okay, Dr. Zainatul. Dr. Sabira, our chief pediatrician of the country. Saya nampak ada nama situ tapi tak dengar, tak nampak muka dia. Anything to add?
Assalamualaikum, Datuk.
Waalaikumsalam. Anything to add?
Yes, I've been listening. I mean, it's all been said very well and presented very well. We have important, it's very important to vaccinate our young adolescent. In fact, we have to look into how to get it done to be our children as well. And I think the side effect, I think, is very minor. We are going to monitor all the children as they vaccinate. And I think the benefit of vaccination is far way than the complication of vaccine. That's from us. And we want the press to convey this message as we discuss in this meeting. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sabira. I think I would like to also thank a lot from our press, rakan-rakan media kita. I think because you guys play a very, very important role, because the vaccine now, we are at the, you know, last mile. We need to make sure that, you know, we use this strategy, make sure that we can get people vaccinated, as many people as possible to be vaccinated, now that we are not looking at, you know, herd immunity anymore, because it's a moving target. You know, I mean, you're not going to actually catch up with the virus. So now we are trying to make sure that as many people as possible that can be vaccinated will be vaccinated safely, and that's our role now, because we are seeing the efficacy, and then the results are showing in the number of cases, number of admission, number of death is coming down. We hope that the trend is going to continue, and we need to move on. We need to live with the virus, and this is one of the strategy. Yeah, certainly this is not the end. We are going to see more development, and we are going to change the way we handle the vaccination strategy as and when more data becomes available. As it is, the vaccine pun is evolving. Ada more formulation, good, better formulation, and we hope to see better, more efficacious, and less side effect formulation, you know, being developed by the manufacturers. Okay, I think with that, I would like to thank everybody for coming for this session. We hope to have similar engagement. As and when necessary, kalau perlu, reach out to us. Kita akan cuba dapatkan the expert to come together and give the whatever information that we could. Kalau tak dapat diberikan semasa engagement session ni, please email me or let us know so that we can provide the information by email or by other means. Yeah. With that, I thank you very much. Ada apa-apa from the Urustia? Kalau tak ada, terima kasih banyak. Ya. Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. A very good evening, everybody. Stay safe, everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you.